Looking to past, let's look to the future. Champs League.
I think both these teams are going to be wanting to look to the future for sure. Trying to redeem the performances from yesterday. We'll start off the ban phase with the Gragas taken off the board for Rocket over to Gambit.
Yeah, that's a really good point you make there. Both teams lost on the first match day, so nobody here wants to go 0-2 in the opening week of the European Summer Split. Gragas banned out. Killist response from Gambit.
Mm-hmm. I think they both have quite a lot to prove here. You know, they both made some roster changes. You know, only one player for Gambit, you could argue that's a bigger impact because it is Forgiven down there. You see him on your screen right now. But we've yet to see much from Steve. Admittedly, he got camped quite a lot yesterday, but I want to see what else he can do aside from the Hecarim.
Yeah, definitely Steve has more to show, but it was his first game. Understandable how that went down. I think once the first mistake was made, the rest was rather inevitable. And yeah, this is the downside of playing with Forgiven. He doesn't like playing Kalista. He doesn't like playing Urgot. He doesn't like playing Sivir. There's not much left.
Yeah.
Especially when Lucian is bad. Is he going to go back to the old meta Grays? Nobody plays Grays right now. Absolutely nobody. But then again, Forgiven transcends meta games and he makes champions on his own. But yeah, that's what I like and dislike at the same time about Forgiven.
Well, there is a lot there. Now, Sejuani's taken off the board. We already saw the Rek'Sai ban. That means we're going to see a very quick Azir pickup for Rocket. It's over to Gambit now. And yeah, all eyes are going to be on those AD carry pickups and see what they dig deep and grab.
And they're definitely looking at Evelynn, I think, in their first rotation because Rek'Sai, Sejuani, and Gragas are out. They leave Azir up. The counterpart of Azir, Cassiopeia, is still there. Not sure if Betsy's is a good Cassiopeia player or not, but he will not pick that. He will very likely not pick that in the first rotation, but we might see Evelynn picked up here by Gambit again. And Caitlyn, however.
We did see Caitlyn being one of Forgiven's backups over the last split, but they don't have to decide this one right now, and I don't think they should be doing that, so instead, see, switching up a little bit of a hover. If Ghost of Pepper gets his hands on Thresh, we'll see what he can do this time around, or if they elect to take that. Also, Morgana, this is a very, very flexible choice for Gambit Gaming. But
again, not when you're looking Thresh.
You don't need to do it right now, yeah. Well, one less roll, I suppose.
Yeah, top end mid. Riven hover.
Interesting.
Yeah, Victor's still there.
Okay, here we go. That's going to get taken. Locked in with the Thresh, back over to Rocket. How do they respond to that?
Damn you, Gambit. Stop toying with my emotions, all these hovers. That's actually a good point. A lot of teams, they hover too many champions. I really like when it's dark, 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 double lock and go. Because it gives away less information to your opponents. Now Rocket could have prepared for the Thresh. And yeah, how will they respond? Alistar, meta support still there. A lot of supports right now, they rate Thresh and Alistar on tier 1. And Maokai, pretty standard. Any top laner worth their salt in the LCS should be able to play a good Watt Maokai. Let's see how Steve does.
Indeed. So something a little bit more, I'd say a little bit more straightforward for him to start this game off. And, you know, of course, Summoner is a little bit more standard on that one. We'll see what Gambit decides to answer with on their side. They still need quite a lot.
Very control heavy from Rocket. These fights with poke and disengage from Azir, Maokai single target lockdown, good peel and engage from Alistar. The way you beat a lot of control is mobility, moving around and making sure that you're in positions where they can't really peel you, where you're quick around the map. Sivir springs to mind, but Sivir is not a Forgiven champion.
Absolutely not. He definitely wants to deal a whole heaping helping of damage, not be a utility AD carry. I'm interested to see what he does go with. The Caitlyn is a distinct possibility. He could go all the way back to Graves. You said he transcends metas. I actually wouldn't mind seeing the Jinx, or maybe he'll pull out Nash.
Questions.
We're going to have to wait to see it, though.
Volibear.
Wow, a Volibear jungle. Okay.
The point I wanted to make is Evelynn is really hard to play in these champions because she's prone to getting all in, and Evelynn's not going to do much against an Alistar. Evelynn's not going to do much against a Maokai, and Evelynn, even when she jumps on a zero dash out, so you want something innately more tanky that can have a little more disruption. If Volibear is the answer, the last time Pyra, somebody had three junglers banned against him and went Volibear, it did not end well. However, that was any LCS, and we're in Europe right now.
Yeah, this is a little bit different. Also, I want to touch on the Jax, too, for Kabo Shard. This is shaping up to be a very interesting composition for Gambit Gaming. I feel their skirmishes are going to be very, very strong, but a little bit more later in the game.
Yeah, I don't think they like grouping too much. It's relatively short-range Jax. He can knocked out or by Alistar or by the Azir. So if Rocket can keep them at bay, I can definitely do a lot of damage there.
Okay, well, I treading on the Kog'Maw grounds. He will decide to take it. This is a champion that he had some mixed play with over the last play.
I think this is to challenge a possible Caitlyn pick. You do not want to pick anything that forces you in a late swap if Gambit chooses to lock from Caitlyn. Kog'Maw has very high innate range. If he pops his W, Caitlyn's already has that range all the time. But yeah, Kog'Maw Alistar has some sustain in there too. If they get to level 6, very potent lane. But they can die, and they can die a lot if Eddie lands those hooks again. And yeah, Lee Sin coming out from Jankos. He's a phenomenal Lee Sin player.
Mm-hmm. Well, he once held the title and, you know, the name of First Blood King, and that was a champion that he definitely helped make the name for himself on. And I'm curious to see what he does do in the very, very early game. But I feel like the game plan is just going to shift on a dime depending on what Forgiven does take here, because this will define how this laning phase will go.
Yeah, well, yes, I know. I think Forgiven plays the same every time. I've yet to see a Forgiven that alters from the preset notion of push-poke on their tower, and it seems that he wants to do the same thing with Ezreal. Being relatively safe, this does offer Ghost Whip Pepper the ability to roam, because Ezreal is a very potent 1v2 farmer. Not Forgiven style, but maybe you can teach an old dog new tricks.
Not to see if he lives up to that moniker, God-given, that the players here in Europe have called him. They give him a lot of respect on that squad. We'll see if Rocket's bot lane does the same. So now, picks are all locked in. Rocket, it's a comp we're probably a little bit more used to seeing. Gambits, though, very, very interesting stuff. The Volibear in particular.
What I really like about Rocket's comp, that is triple disengage. You're going at you go after Nuke Duck, Jankos can kick you away. If you miss, Vander can headbutt you out, and if you're still in there, then Nukta can use his own Azir ultimate, move his Sand Soldiers forward. And if at any way you're still there, they have a Twisted Advance from Maokai. So if they can get Nukta fed, and it's possible because in the later stages of the game, Gambit's CS share is incredibly tilted towards Cavalshard on one side and Forgiven on the other side. Betsy ranked 8th among all the other mid laners in the LCS in terms of who gets what CS. And if he doesn't get many resources and Nukta can exert a lot of pressure and he can get fed, he can become the cornerstone for Rocket's composition and potentially carry.
We'll see if that ends up being the case. The lineups are locked, the teams are ready to take to the Rift, but why don't you guys get on Twitter and tell us how you think this one is going to play out. Your hashtags are ROCWin, our GMBWin. The crowd gets hyped for this game. We zoom on in. And into the Rift we go. Team Rocket versus Gambit Gaming, starting up.
Jax top lane, Maokai top lane. I think Rocket would be okay if they could manage to swap. Swapping away from Forgiven. However, he farms like a monster even if you're in the lane or not. So you'll get maximum CS anyways. So you might as well make your life easier and swap away from him. Kog'Maw definitely wants to get to level 6. In a lane swap situation as well, you'd get more XP on your AD carry, less on your support. Speaks into the favor of Kog'Maw for sure as well, so we might see Rocket attempt a lane swap.
Mm-hmm. You know, one thing Rocket's team comp will do particularly well after they get out of that laning phase, we'll be able to siege. Between Nuke Talk and Woolite, they have a lot of damage. If Gambit tries to go all in, as you mentioned, there's always the possibility of disengage.
But, good read by Pepper.
He's caught early. Ghost Soup Pepper made it happen. Cabochard won't get anywhere near him with Counter-Strike, but Woolite is forced to burn a flash very early.
They have to swap Werner. If you go into that lane without a flash, then you're asking for a whole lot of trouble. In addition, if you swap, you keep Cavalshard down relatively to the other members in the game, and that's what you want to do against the Jax. Yes, he might be good at double jungling, but you deny him levels at least, and that's something you really want to do. Is Rocket going to opt in for that swap or not?
We'll have to see. Right now, a lot of pings are flying towards the top side for Gambit, the bottom side for Rocket. As the minions start taking to the Rift, it looks like we're going to be having some help on the red buff.
No. Sapling tosses coming out from Steve, indicating a supportive role. Nuketuck is likely to take these three Wraiths. I want to see if we can get the camera on there. He's going to take those Wraiths and get a CS or a level advantage on the mid lane. That means he levels up on the first wave and can maybe surprise and poke out Betsy. Meanwhile, Betsy's actually assisting Cabochard in taking the camp and the Wraiths.
Yeah, actually, this should be a very good start for Nuketuck.
Yeah. Raptor call it what you want.
Raptor Ace sounds pretty cool. Not right now, though. Cabochard will be working on the Raptors of his own. Fox goes actually quite low. There we go. He's going to be able to get that smite down. So, healing up. Nice early clear for Volibear.
Good guy, Steve. Still managed to do Wolves on his own. Gets a camp in, just like Cabochard, just a little slower. So, he'll be TPing out quite a bit slower. But both bot lanes took a camp as well. Let's see how this plays out.
Cabochard's going to spend his teleport really early. But here he will be followed closely by Steve. So, for a while, those guys will probably not be leaving the top lane. We'll see how that one goes. Check back in on it in a little bit later. But let's take a look how what Amazing has to say about this. Volibear is going to work, guys. Trust me. All right.
It takes one to know one. Now, in any experimental picks, you need one guy to be the hero. You need one guy to lay the groundwork, to take the sacrifice, to volunteer as tribute. And that was Amazing. He took the first step, and then maybe Diamond Prox is going to finish it.
Well, we have no Diamond Prox as a man not very afraid to try things that not a lot of people are trying. Yesterday didn't quite work so well with the Evelynn. Of course, a lot of people had more success than that.
He's not afraid to go where no other jungler has gone before.
Fountain? Sometimes. You just got to dive as far as possible. Let's see what Forgiven and Ghost Pepper are up to. Taking a look at this bottom lane. They've pushed the wave in just a little bit, but again, Will and Vander, they didn't opt for this swap. It's going to be dangerous for Will for a little while more without this flash, but for right now, he's staying safe.
So, the good thing about not having flash and playing against Forgiving is that he's going to push you on the tower. So at least you can't get caught by the jungler. Now, this is where your synergy on your bot lane shows how well you're going to see us on a tower. Good headbutt. That headbutt solidified that CS for Wulite. It took the tower longer to get there. Ghost of Pepper going for those signature hooks on their tower. He wants to wait until Wulite locks in an auto attack animation on the creep, or predict when Wulite's walking up for a creep, and then hook him, and then get the poke from Forgiven. However, there is very little all-in potential.
Yeah, and not to mention, despite being down that key summoner for Wulite, you know, he was, as you mentioned, able to really read that and say, okay, well, they're going to push us under tower. We're going to stay safe. He's kept even on farm, importantly enough. So that early play has not really had any negative impact on Rocket's lane.
Yeah, definitely good point. If this lane gets to level six router, Kog'Maw can wreak some havoc. They're going for a gank on Steve, though.
Speaking of havoc, Steve, he's had this happen to him yesterday. He gets flipped over with the Rolling Thunder, but there's a couple of flashes, and they take a bite out of the tree. That's going to be first blood over to Diamond Prox.
Steve not respecting the gank enough. He could have flashed way earlier. He waited for Diamond Prox to fling him in and then flashed out. That means you're not going to get out of there alive. You need to respect that if your bottom lane is pushed in, you have an Azir in the mid lane, and you're playing against Diamond Prox pairing with Cavishard, it is very, very likely, given history, that you're going to get ganked. Dying here is a mistake.
Absolutely. So first casualty of the match. It's going to be Steve once again. Picks up that second Doran's Ring and waddles his way up. It's going to be a while before he has a teleport available, so he has to take the slow path. Meanwhile, down back in the bottom, Wulite and Vander sustaining pretty well, but Ghost of Pepper nomming on that biscuit.
2 points in healer for Vandal as well. He prioritizes sustain because he knows once Wulite hits six, enough damage in the lane coming out of two people. Vander blocks that hook. This is what you have to do, and we saw Miffy do it yesterday on Alistar as well. That hook comes out, and you can hit two targets. Either hits Kog'Maw or Alistar. Who do you want it to hit? Alistar, obviously. And it's really good, because then Wulite has the return damage, and this, the follow-up is not enough damage from Ezreal and Thresh to really solidify a lead. Lucas going in.
Oh, yes, he does. Put a little bit more damage onto Betsy after swerving around the minions for just a second. Forces him out of lane. That means he'll have to farm all to himself, and he needs it. He's been down a couple of CS from the start of the game.
Yeah, Gambit will have to rely on Cavishard to snowball this because CS on bot lane pretty even and time plays into their favor. However, the mirror is true on the opposite side because Cavishard just wants more time. He wants to scale. Yangos is looking to even things out.
See if Cavishard sniffs this one out. Steve going a little bit forward. Cavishard starts off the Counter-Strike. He gets knocked back. The Counter-Strike only going to hit the minions. Yankos still waiting patiently. He's going to hop in. He gets the Q connected, but Cavishard hops himself away. And now he'll be safe under tower.
Ever so satisfying sound of Jax Alstedding.
I can't really get enough of him. There it goes.
If he gets the creeps. Steve got some breathing room from that gank. Yes, it didn't give him a kill, but level 6 Cavishard, he might instantly go aggressive because he know Yankos is probably not around anymore.
Yeah, look at Diamond Prox. Diamond Prox is making his move up. He knows he's not spotted as he wanders through the Tri-Brush, the Pink Ward, making certain of that. Steve, though, he's got to know something is up. Teams have already keyed off on him, and now Yankos is coming up to help once again preemptively.
Yeah, but they lose the 2v2. That's the problem. Yankos is such a good jungler if you can give him freedom to go to any lane that he wants to and control the pace of the game. However, Steve has so far had the habit from falling behind and he requires attention, and that's not what you want to do. When you pick Maokai, you want to stay safe.
Well, that's not exactly what Steve is doing right now. He throws in the Ventral Maelstrom and he's still hanging around. Actually, Cavishard is the one that goes down as Diamond Prox is just a step too slow. However, he might find the return kill onto Yankos. No, there's the safeguard. Meanwhile, down in the bottom, Ghost of Pepper gets a hook on a Wulite. They've got a lot of damage and forcing the heal. Forgiven, blood, he's selling, he smells it up and he grabs the kill. Now, he's gonna take take a blast from the Akathian surprise, but the parting shot won't be enough to take down.
Positional mistake by Wuad, but fantastic hook from Ghost of Pepper. Maybe the Thresh King is back after all. Really, really solid hook. Almost looked really grim for Gambit, but they turn it around. If you're wondering why Vanir flashed there, he basically wanted to try to block the next Ezreal Mystic shot, but Forgiven was barely in range to finish Wuad off. Otherwise, good defensive supportive play, but was enough. Vanir also commits his flash. Gonna cancel this back here.
That's just
cheeky
rude.
Little play. Yeah. Oh, you kill my AD carry?
Yeah.
I'll cancel you back.
All is fair in League of Legends.
Indeed it is.
Meanwhile, back to the mid. Yeah, Pepper's roaming just a little bit now. And you know, this is easily enough for him to do. It's gonna be a little while before there's any more pressure on the map. You take a look. After that back, you see that Forgiven is able to acquire his first piece of the Trinity Force, the Sheen, picked up. So he's going more traditional Ezreal build, not that blue build that we have seen quite a lot of.
Now, with that advantage, Ghost of Pepper could have opted for the side stone, however he wants. He feels safe enough in his lane that he's not going to get bursted, that he goes for Moment's double ward, gets deep vision. They want to localize where Jankos is on the map, see if they can spot him, and maybe safely take down his dragon.
Yeah, well, they're starting it off. Diamond Fox tanking up the damage, but they do have the Victor here with the Siphon Power to be able to push this one back. It's spotted by Vander, but there really isn't anything Rocket can do about it. And as a result, Gambit Gaming secure their first dragon just shy of 9 minutes.
It is a pretty ballsy play to play Moby Boots into a Kog'Maw, though. A couple of those artilleries, and you're down to half HP, and suddenly you lose your all-in potential, and Wuad keeps scaling. However, those deep wards facilitated the dragon, and definitely hashtag worth for Gambit.
Mm-hmm. Ghost of Pepper won't be complaining as long as he stays nice and hidden. He doesn't get hit by those living artillery shells. Meanwhile, just keeps on moving around. Fancy feet to dodge out our Mystic, or rather a True Shot Barrage.
Cannon creep gets blocked, he's not gonna get it. He's like, alright, I'll just use my ultimate instead. I want all that farm, and that's fine. Forgiven's one job
in this
game is just to farm, and they want to get all the attention to the top lane. Stun on Steve!
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 Steve! Okay, he's alright.
He's alright.
Shard's able to push this one back. Forgiven actually takes some decent damage down on the bottom. Willite and Vander were return firing onto him, but still, it's been an ever-present threat of getting locked up by that Thresh hook. Willite has to be careful on his positioning.
And if you look down into the blue buff of Rocket, we see two deep wards placed as well, so they're tracking Jankos. They don't want to get a surprise counter gank from Jankos one more time. And if they can avoid that, Gambit can really start snowballing. Ghost Pepper basing for some more wards, not picking up any HP, but yeah, he feels fine and safe in his bot lane. Very neutral bot lane. They need to snowball the rest of the map though, because eventually Kog'Maw will get out of control, especially with Sheen. The poke potential is very, very high.
Mm-hmm. Both AD carries with that Sheen, but yeah, it's going to be on Forgiven to try and keep this Kog'Maw down. Diamond Prox moving up once again to the top side, that pink ward untouched. Jankos is there as well. It seems like what these junglers' senses are a tingling. Steve has some backup, but what he doesn't know is there's a big bear there, and there is Jankos as well, focusing on Steve. Can they pick him off? A flash. Kabushard gets the kill. Jankos on the retreat. They want the blue buff. A jump. A flash from Jankos away.
And this time, Gambit is prepared. They're not going to fall for the same trick twice. The 2v2, they will win regardless, as long as Diamond Proc shows up on time, and he does. And this is getting really ugly. Steve is 0-2-1. Looking for a repeat performance of yesterday.
Oh, wow. Forgiven cross-map farming even as he helps out clear the wave in the top side.
And with that cross-map farming, he puts himself 4 CS ahead of Wuad, whereas earlier he was behind. Teleport from Steve.
Yep, they aren't looking for Forgiven just yet. It's Ghost of Pepper. They've got their sights set on, but Wuad very low. In goes Forgiven. Wuad's going to pick off Ghost of Pepper. There's a teleport coming in for Kabushard, but is it too late as Ghost of Pepper's already gone down? That's a double kill for Wuad. Kabushard jumping forward. And now Betsy's in the mix. He throws down the Death Laser, but that's going to be it for the aggression right now. Both AD carries down and the support of Gambit.
Wuad with the illustrious melee range Kog'Maw, but it was all planned because the Akathian surprise took down Forgiven in the end. Double kill for Kog'Maw. Exactly what you want. You want your kills on this Kog'Maw, if not on your Azir. And this somehow worked out for Rocket pretty well.
Yep, they're mirroring their builds right now. Both looking towards that Trinity Force. Jankos, after all of that, is going to be heading up back towards mid through his jungle. Take stock of where we are in this game right now. It's a slim 1,000 gold lead over to Gambit. They've also got the dragon, though, so they are in a favorable position. But as you mentioned before, there's a ticking timer, and its name is Wuad.
Yeah, definitely looking at Nuketuk as well for later. You highlighted it earlier. The siege potential in Rocket's lineup is very high, but now top lane, yeah, very rough. The longer this goes on, the more ganks that go out, the more ganks in favor of Kabushard, the harder his snowball, and soon he'll be able to 1v1 Steve, opening up the resource that is Diamond Pucks for the rest of the team. Forgiving's farming fine on his own, 3CS difference. Not exactly what you want, but you have to make sacrifices. And they're letting Kog'Maw get ahead while staying safe on the bot lane, hoping that the snowball in mid and potentially top is enough for this game. But
yeah, I mean, it's a fair point. Gambit, they have a timer ticking for themselves as well. The Jax becomes very, very powerful regardless of how that lane goes. And it's been going very favorable for him. Now, though, he's got to smell something is up. Steve is playing very forwardly aggressive, and Kabushard a level ahead of him. He knows Jankos is in that bush. He does not need a ward to take.
Yeah, look at Diamond Fox immediately reacting. He says, Kabushard says, I'm about to push out. I'm going to need help. I don't want to face check these brushes on my own. Definitely playing towards the top side. Correct decision. But the gold is pretty close, and more farm on Azir is definitely going to be very brutal for this short-range composition on Gambit. Yes, Ezreal has some poke, but Victor, if he has to get too close and ever gets caught by later, a righteous glory from Steve. Yes, he's behind 0, 2, and 3, but he can still do his job, which is Righteous Glory, Twisted Advance, catch one guy out, and Rocket follow-up with enough damage coming out of this double threat composition. Nuketok still in good shape. Wulite, rather, on the Kog'Maw, also in prime shape.
Right, and I think this is why they made the decision to pick this Maokai, and we'll see how it goes throughout the game. The issue is they're going to need to eventually spend some attention on Kabushard. Just hasn't happened when Jankos has been there. Diamond Prox has always been there to follow up, so they haven't found any counter-aggression. Vander takes
the
hooked up, play backwards.
Look at the counter damage.
Yeah, Wulite, he has so much here. Meanwhile, back to mid, Betsy, Emperor's Divide, Jankos is there. Betsy's going down, and Nuketok finds himself in a storm of chaos, but he should be able to get out.
And this is exactly what I said earlier on the bot lane. Vander takes the hook. There's not enough damage to take him down because he has ultimate. There's not enough damage to take Wulite down. And the counter poke from Kog'Maw is so high. Ghost of Pepper had to use his play defensively, and he's constantly scared of that Alistar knockup. And Rocket, they're outscaling bot lane from Gambit step by step by step.
Yeah, that gold lead has shrunk to a mere 200 right now. Hook goes a little bit wide, but Wulite was playing with fire. However, he's got Jankos here to back him up. Rocket want to push this in quick. They want to force backs. They want to be able to open up this dragon for them, but they need to be very careful about this. There's a Bulbarian coming, but Vander, he's going to take the offensive. Ghost of Pepper's going down. Forgiven can do nothing else about this. And
very,
this tower is
very hard to cancel that combo from Vander, especially when you have no flash. You need a perfect play. Almost landed it. This tower goes down because Forgiven didn't build a tier. He went for the straight Triforce, so eventually he got out of mana. Wulite's W right now costs no mana, so he can keep using it over and over again. They take down a tower, and they might actually snowball the dragon.
Yeah, they will be able to do it, but they'll have to do it without the help of the Scuttle Crab Shrine, as that was picked up cheekily by Diamond Prox and all of that. The Jax has teleport if he wants to try and make this a 3v3, because Betsy and Diamond are on the backside. Forgiven sends the ultimate out, Dragon's already gone. Can they get the return fight? Vander face tanks it. He's going down to Diamond Prox.
Yeah, they're just going
to
flash out there.
Has to flash. Yeah, they have to give up Vander for that. Tribute for the dragon, I'd say warp.
I'd definitely call that warp. And Rocket just equalized the game. They're 1,000 gold ahead now, and they stopped the bleeding, and their main tank is still alive and doing okay. Steve can still fulfill his job, finish the Righteous Glory, building some Arena.
Uh-oh.
Hook on Jankos.
Jankos, he's flayed back, he's knocked back, he kicks back, but he's dead.
Yeah, great hook by Ghost of Pepper there. Jankos a little greedy on his base position because after doing the dragon, they left their jungle exposed.
All right, well, not sure if the Thresh Prince is back, but he's definitely a Thresh Baron this game.
Moving up on the ranks. Eventually, he'll get there.
Order of
Who's
succession.
A Thresh King? There's a Thresh Prince.
Oh, that's a good point. I don't know.
Thresh God is Madlife. Oh, a little
boy.
Short.
Well, the Prince might be going down in just a moment. Gosu Pepper evaporates. Vander picks that one up, but Steve in a heaping helping of trouble. Betsy picks him up. Diamond Prox nearly followed. All said and done, it's a 1-for-1.
Yeah, where Soren succeeded rather last game in those double Azir plays. Nuketok just fell a little short, almost knocked the Ghost of Pepper into the tower. Vander had to follow up with a combo, and Steve sacrificed himself. The 1-for-1, progressively getting worth less and less gold. Maybe it's an economical game plan coming out from Rocket here. Inflation at its finest. Steve about to go 0-6, perhaps?
Quite possibly. And his tower is gone after a couple of tunks from Kabushard. The Jax getting into the full swing of things, and he might be looking for the second tier tower pretty soon. No, he backs away.
And we're playing gold lead yo-yo now. Gambit 1,000 gold ahead once again. It's going back and forth, but time, in my opinion, speaks in Rocket's favor. So they're decently happy with the way this game is going.
I don't think Gambit is too unhappy about it either, though. This is settling into a very interesting mid-game where, as you mentioned, it has been yo-yoing gold lead. Not just that, but the overall power of both these teams has been going back and forth. Kabushard's getting pretty scary. He's got the Trinity Force completed. A little bit of lacking on the mobility since he still hasn't picked up basic boots, though.
Yeah, but looking at Rocket's team composition, they have the means to deal with the Jax if he gets too fed. They don't even have to fight it. They can kick him out of the fight. They can use the Azir to get him out of the fight. They can use Vanner's knockbacks, knock-ups, and Steve's Twisted Advance to keep him busy and deal with the rest of Gambit's lineup. However, eventually, you'll have to face him, and that's going to get rough.
They will have to deal with it eventually. No sense in putting it off, or maybe there is for a few minutes.
I definitely want to see some flanking come out of Gambit. If everybody... Oh, Nuketech's going in.
Yep, there's the drive-by. It's Betsy who gets kicked, and Jankos finishes the job.
Yeah, Nuketech learned from his mistake. Flawless execution on that play, and... What is the counterplay when your flash is down on Betsy? It's probably not going for CS. Look at Woolite, red buff.
Yep, he's able to chase down Forgiven. There is the arcane shift. He'll get out of danger. Gosu Pepper was rushing to his defense, but he just can't simply tangle with Woolite right now.
This matchup is spiraling out of control on the bot lane.
One does not simply outpoke a Kog'Maw.
Nope. Now in these short, long-range trains, Forgiven has to land all his spells, especially in addition to red buff there. It's really rough to deal with that.
Long-range farming.
Long-range farm.
Does it all the time. Let's see what Diamond Prox decides to do next. Throwing out a couple of deeper wards. Kabushard in on the red buff, and Diamond Prox will be there just in case.
Nice smite for the setup. Lance to get out. Good steal.
Nicely done. And methodical moves from Gambit Gaming. They find themselves still 500 gold in the lead.
All right, let's take a look at the bigger picture. Rocket fell behind early, but they're getting better, and they're learning from their mistakes. Steve's playing safer. He knows what his job is. Their double threat is staying into the in the game. Nuketech learned from his one failure in the mid lane, has flawless execution on two. We need to find a name for that. Twitter, Azir Insect. What is that name? Because I have no idea what to call it.
I think we've been working with Azirsec, but yeah, if you guys Azirsec, got a better one, let us
drive by, whatever.
At OL Esports, come on guys, we want to hear it.
He got some kills, three assists now on Nuketech, and two kills on Woolite, so they're definitely getting right for that siege that you mentioned earlier.
Yep. Given sends a true shot barrage, doesn't quite clear the wave, but they will be able to defend for now. Meanwhile, Kabushard's back on the bottom. There's no one here to stop him, and the Jax will be Jax.
Yeah, definitely. Oh, okay, they're people pushing, but they're looking to collapse on him. Are they going to lose their middle tower for this, though?
Yeah, it looks like Gambit is eyeballing a couple different things at the same time. Kabushard, can he get back? It's going to be a dangerous mission. He gets headbutted by Vander, knocked up there. Nuketech inbound. Kabushard is going down. It's only a matter of time. Denied his leap as he gets pushed back into the wall. But meanwhile, Gambit Gaming are ready to answer back. They take a tower for it in the mid.
And this is 1-3-1 at its finest. If you try to cut off one head, two more will take its place. You cut off the bottom lane, middle gets pushed, top lane gets pushed. You're losing towers because you commit to get that kill and you have to stop the bleeding somehow. The way you do that is you stop it before it happens. But Pepper's caught.
Yeah, he is. He manages to throw the box down, get himself out of harm's way. Steve makes his move up, but he's stopped by the gravity field. Now he turns on the pressure. Twisted
on Betsy.
Onto Betsy. Do they have the damage? It looks like they might. Diamond Prox. Steve was not sure who to go for. Tosses the sapling out. But a ghost from Betsy means he can get away. Vander comes in. Diamond Prox is shut down. A whole heaping helping of gold onto Woolite. But Forgiven, just like the Hydra, they're pushing something else. Anytime they can in Kabushard. Oh my goodness,
but
look at this teleport.
Forgiven's not strong enough to take the tower down. And it is actually pretty good for Rocket. Kabushard with the TP dirty farming to stop the push somehow. I'm not sure if this is worth it because Nuketech's flanking.
It's going on a bit of a secret mission. But yeah, Nuketech.
Is that worth the teleport?
Come out. I'm really not sure about that. That was a strange move from Kabushard.
All right, what just happened, Pyra?
All right, let's take a step back. We'll calm down just a little bit. Let's go back all the way to that pickoff on bot. Heavy investment from Rocket. All of a sudden, Gambit go into a bit of a frenzy, grab themselves
two towers
out of it. But then they get a little greedy, and it gets a little crazy from then on out. And I think they just sort of barely make it out with their lives. And now, again, we talked about that yo-yo. Gambit, it's in their favor right now. But it can turn on a dime. We've seen Rocket making some huge plays. Let's see if they continue now. Dragon is live. We could see a real 5v5 anytime.
Now, what you may not be tracking all the time is flash cooldowns. Betsy had to use his flash. Diamond Prox had to use his flash. Really important for these Dragon fights. With the amount of disengage and peel on Rocket's side and poke and siege, flashes are incredibly important in addition to flanking. So while it may look that Gambit just got a 2,000 gold lead, they invested some of their really important flashes to do so. And that makes the Righteous Glory even more valuable.
Right, and especially more important, if Rocket utilize that timing window, they can get some really big gains out of it, as opposed to if they don't, then it's Gambit have lost nothing for it effectively.
Yep. The burden of the outplay is right now on Rocket, and they have to find a way to control this dragon area, force Gambit into a choke point, and then use the Azir ultimate to their advantage. Forgiving gets poked.
He gets poked a lot. And now Rocket, a few minions at their back. Let's see, they're going to peel away. They're going to be looking for this dragon. Diamond Prox had the Scuttlecrab Shrine down already. Pink Ward cleared away. Let's see if they start this one up.
Steve has one job, and that is keeping Cabochard from flanking on Rocket team.
He's a little bit slow to arrive, but this dragon is going down. It looks like Rocket will secure that one up, and there's no response from Gambit, so they do get a dragon out of all that. Gambit were a little bit spooked without those cooldowns.
Yeah, definitely could not stop that dragon, else it's got an ugly. Jankos is going for a play. Close.
Very, very close. You can see a lot of trust in that bot lane, though. Like, Forgiven sat very far out in front, knowing the Lantern was right about to be there, and instantaneous response.
Yeah, I'm not sure if I like the Ezreal, though. It seems too slow in the mid to late game compared to the Kog'Maw.
And the build, too. I mean, we talked about him getting back to the more traditional Ezreal Trinity Force, now going towards a Bloodthirster. But, you know, this can potentially have those mana problems. We've seen it manifest itself already once. Look, he's already a little bit low. He's just back to base. You know, that's going to be all well and good. And yes, he can cross-map farm anytime he wants, but when you're not actively in the fights, that does limit your presence quite a bit.
You looked at Forgiven. I'll take a look at Wulai here, and he's very close to finishing his Blade of the Ruined King, and against the likes of a Jax and a Volibear, that's going to be really important. Combine that with his W passive. I really like Triforce Bork as a build, especially on Kog'Maw, and yeah, it's working wonders.
It sure is. Now, Cabochard should be able to finally polish off that turret. He does with a couple more knocks. Steve is there. He's going to be very, very careful. He does not want to take a straight one-on-one.
Gambit is 3,000 gold ahead of Rocket, though. Let's not forget that if he was to keep raising Rocket's composition and the possibilities that they have to get farther into this game. However, Gambit is 3,000 gold ahead, so they're definitely doing something right. Are they going to be able to finish these last tier 2 towers? That's the question. If that happens, they can maybe transition into some Baron baits. They still have more of the pressure. Rocket's comp has to slowly move up step by step by step. Poke, siege, poke, siege. Be wary of flanks. They have to take it slow. Whereas Gambit, they can be explosive, and that's the way Gambit likes playing. Spreading people around the map and then collapsing on one target. See hero, kill hero, rather, back to Moscow 5.
Exactly, and you know, the troubling thing for Rocket is that, yes, they'll want to take it slow, they'll want to execute later on in the game, and look at this.
Oh, I love this play.
25
look at that ward, look at that ward.
They don't see
illusion of safety. Really solid play to do that Baron from behind. Really risky that Forgiven sends out that two-shot barrage, so coming from the Baron. This might give it away.
Yeah, it just might. They're not taking it down quite quick enough. They just don't have quite
enough
damage here without the Victor, but I think it's going to happen. However,
Jankos is coming.
Jankos and Vander, we could see the lead.
Jankos and the steal!
He gets the steal off! Telegraph just too soon. Forgiven, able to get to safety, but Rocket secure the Baron, and Gosu Pepper is a snack for Wulai.
I wish I could listen to the team comms right now, how they spotted that Baron. Did they sniff it out? Did they see the two-shot barrage come from the top left side of the map? If they did, why? Why was Forgiven shooting his ulti from there? What was he doing that warranted his position? It must have been the Baron. And he would have gotten away with it if it wasn't for that meddling Forgiven.
Well, as it stands, the walls of Gambit Gaming, the towers, I should say, are crumbling away. Super minions now pushing in all these lanes. As Wulite, uncontested with Vander, starts to chunk away at this top side. There is a Diamond Prox inbound, but they have found themselves a steady roll of momentum, and Diamond Prox has to bail out as he sees Jankos around the side. Rocket have found an in this game, and they have amassed a 3,000 gold lead.
If you're playing any compositions like 4-1 or 1-3-1, the one thing you love a lot is Baron. If you get it, you win the game. If you lose it, it can get really brutal.
Speaking of losing it, that's gotta hurt.
Yeah. Cheeky little steal from Jankos there. That has to feel good. If you're Jankos right now.
Absolutely.
You're a Rocket. You placed really poorly in the spring split. You lost pretty hard yesterday. Steve got behind. You stay in his game, and then magically you get that Baron steal. This means a lot.
And you know, importantly this game, if you look at Steve, yes, he did start out quite far behind, but he's on a champion that he's still able to perform well on. He's done his job very solidly, and he stopped feeding.
He stopped feeding. He stopped the bleeding, and he stopped the feeding. Solid drive by Steve. Itemized really well in addition to that. Righteous Glory into Frozen Heart, and now building some magic resistance. Perfect itemization from Steve. Getting more comfortable on the LCS stage. What is Diamond Prox doing here?
Looks like he's...
Who's catching who?
Secret mission. I'm not totally sure, but Diamond Prox is denied from Nuke Duck.
Rotation from Rocket.
Yep. Three members, four members, they're looking to take down this turret quick. No minions at their back, but will they tank it? Woolite's actually tanking a few shots. There's the minions. Just took him a second to catch back up. That tower is gone. Meanwhile, there's a Jax on the top side, but I don't know if he's going to win this race.
Not because Steve has the Baron buff, and he can stop the Jax from pushing, so Gammon wants to engage on this. Is Gammon Prox going to go for the flank?
He's definitely thinking about it right now, but Jankos takes it to him before he can do it.
And the game stabilized again. And yes, this Baron buff is so vital to defend split push in one regard and to make the split push stronger in the other. If Gambit got that Baron, that 1-3-1 would have been explosively so much stronger. However, it works as a band-aid for Rocket to stop the bleeding and allow them to finally give them the time to make the push themselves. Really, really crucial Baron. Game-changing.
Absolutely. And now they can take down this tower. No fuss, no muss. They get themselves even further ahead in the goal game. The Dragon's just under a minute away. They can just set up for this leisurely. Although Gambit, after they base, they have to respond. They have to stop their own bleeding.
TP coming in from Cabochard. They want to catch Rocket out.
They want to catch at least Jankos out. He is the deepest in enemy territory right now, but they're not quite chasing on him just yet. There they go. Cabochard jumps on, kicked away by Jankos. 15 seconds now on the drain counter. Teleport coming in. There's a flash burn by Forgiven. Nuke Duck chased around by the Chaos
Knight.
Cabochard going in, but he's isolated. Woolite now is in some trouble, but he's the one who gets flipped back after shutting down Woolite. Jankos going down as well. Akathian surprise, clipping the edge of Gosu Pepper. Now with three members alive, can Rocket still take this fight? I don't think so. Steve, he's still making the play. A double kill now for Vander. Gosu Pepper, he's going to go down in just a moment. They're still making it happen. Nuke Duck, how the hell did he live? And Gambit Gaming are on the losing end of that fight.
Absolutely bonkers fight here by both teams. Woolite with, I think, the aggressive flash, gets caught off guard, goes down immediately, but Nuke Duck strong enough to carry that fight for Rocket. Double threat composition. Let's see that again. Look at the prediction hook by Pepper, but Jankos stops because he gets stunned by Cabochard. Kicks in the stun animation. Really beautiful play. See how this fight evolves. Disengage your Nuke Duck, flashes out of Betsy's ultimate. Really solid play. Flashes aggressively with Diamond Prox in his back. I'd call it a bit of a tunnel vision. Or he has faith how this, you know, clairvoyant. He knows how this fight's gonna play out. Forgiven dash is over, good. Steve's tanking so much. His itemization working wonders for him. Watch Vander pick up this double kill later as well.
Yeah.
Oh, it's fantastic.
Turned in their favor.
Double knockup.
That is the definition of a crazy fight. It was all over the place. Targets shuffling and shifting constantly. But as a result, Rocket, they came out ahead. They've still got that lead. It's about 5,000 gold for themselves. They're looking to pick up Dragon number 3. With extra mobility, and Gambit are nowhere near to try and stop this.
Yeah, Rocket's definitely in a driving seat here. Three Dragons added mobility to get away from this Gambit roster. No flash for Woolite, but the 5% move is going to be absolutely vital to stay away from this Volibear. You don't want to get flung into the enemy team, as long as you can survive that, rather, and kite. Take it step by step, slow enough to poke Gambit out. That's exactly what you want to do. And look at, let's take a look at this graph.
Yeah, it looks like you can see where the trends have shifted back and forth. That massive spike in favor of Rocket, that came right after the Baron Steel, looks like. And you can see how their fortunes have shifted in the positive.
Definitely can see the yo-yoing here in the gold gains, up and down, over and over, until eventually Rocket got on top and stayed on top.
Gains keep on coming for Rocket right now. Gambit on the back foot, trying to find an in further into this game. But Rocket are far from perfect. Those fights have been quite chaotic. And Woolite, he has to be careful. He had a lot of trouble with this kind of thing, with his positioning over the course of last split. And that could bite Rocket again.
Yeah. Well, it was a little unlucky, I guess. He was just looking above his screen and he didn't see Diamond Prox approaching. But at the same time, flashing in aggressively can buy your team enough time. Because you're trading the damage first, right? You shoot first, they shoot back. And that's really important in these team fights when you're already ahead. You can take the liberty to make these flashes. Wouldn't do it too much on Kog'Maw.
And they still won the fight,
they still won the fight, indeed. Next Baron is going to be crucial. Definitely the snowballing tool that Rocket's looking for. But Steve's, he got tanky enough, right? He started in 0-3, but he's 1-3 and 8 now. Definitely respecting 3.0 KDA and holding his grounds. And Cabochard, he lost the momentum, he lost the tempo, he was forced to start building defensively, and he can't break through that rock wall that is Steve. And the remaining 4v4 is turning definitely into Rocket's favor.
Yeah, Gambit realizes this. They're going to need to pull some trickery to try and win any outright fight. So, Gosu Pepper's going back at the moment. And as you mentioned, yeah, the game has settled down, but I think this Baron will be a very big tell-all for where the momentum shifts.
And Kog'Maw snowballing even more. Kog'Maw is such a good hyper carry because every additional item that you build works so well. He goes Triforce Bork, and now the Phantom Dancer, more movement speed and more attack speed, giving that percentual health damage even more value in those fights against those double tank compositions. Betsy's gonna have a hard time even getting to him. The burden of the outplay is definitely on Gambit right now.
Oh yeah. Now Rocket are saying, come at us.
They're confident.
We've got the damage.
Baron in full vision.
In comes the True Shot Barrage. They know this is happening. Gambit in on the hunt, but the Baron's already gone. Diamond procs now. He doesn't really look that tanky, does he? As Gosu Pepper is the next target. Vander stunned up momentarily. Cabo Shard finds himself a Woolite, but he doesn't find the kill just yet. Finally, he will. Cabo Shard gets the assassination, but he's surely going to die for this one. Or not. Yes, he will. Finally, Nuke Duck Sand Soldiers finish the job. 2-for-1 in favor of Rocket, and they've got the Baron on 4.
Woolite is very, very feelers, to say the least. But yeah, good peeling from Rocket. They know they can burn out the Baron because they have so many peeling tools to keep Diamond Fox out of that fight because they know he didn't have Flash. So Volibear has to walk into a Baron pit somehow against the Lee Sin kick, against Maokai Twisted Advance, against Nuke Duck's ultimate, and if all that fails, Baron can just press W and knock him out anyway. So hard for Diamond Fox to get in there. Arguably not even worth a Gambit to try and contest that.
Yeah, and it seems like, obviously Gambit are going to want to go for Woolite. They're going to key off on him because they know they can pick him off, even in what on paper looks like a Protect the AD carry comp. The issue is, you've got Nuke Duck. You've got a 3-0-7 Azir who is causing so much problems for this Gambit gaming squad. And to be honest, Steve, Jankos, and Vander are doing their fair share. Despite being a big frontline, they are doing some serious damage.
Yeah, I'm definitely a big Azir fan. And just, it fits Nuke Duck's style, really slowly ramping up until you get to the point where your Emperor's Divide can really carry these fights on your own, and you don't even need Woolite anymore. Yes, it's nice that he deals damage, but Azir does so much damage in the late game, and Betsy, with his entire team running forward, trying to claw their way through the tank line of Rocket, he's kind of left to his own Divine, and anybody just closing the gap on him will mean that he immediately blows up. He doesn't even have Zhonyas ready because he's behind and he's forced to itemize so offensively.
Exactly, and this is the problem for Gambit because their AP damage has been so negated right now. Wait a minute, we'll talk
base
about that later.
Race.
We've got ourselves a base race. Rocket are a little bit ahead in that one, and they are playing chicken. Only Forgiven wants to stay. This could turn disastrous as Rocket has already finished off one inhibitor. Gambit are back, but Kabushard slowed down. The base race has ended, and Rocket look to be the ones ahead here, but the fight is going crazy. One Nexus turret down. Diamond Prox isolated from his team. He falls as well. Vander dangerously low, but he manages to make his escape. And he narrowly dodges out the True Shot Barrage.
Yeah, when you have an Alistar with Unbreakable Will up, minions are optional when you're pushing. You can literally just walk in, pop your ultimate, tank the tower. If that fails, Steve probably has 200, 300 armor right now. He can tank towers too.
Yeah, and look at the result of all of that. Gambit decided against good judgment to try and take that race. They got absolutely nothing for it. A few hits of damage on the tower, but they lost an inhibitor turret, they lost an inhibitor, they lost a Nexus turret and Diamond procs.
The bright side, they get more farm now, though. Those super creeps pushing.
Yeah,
in.
I mean, I guess
get the late game, boys.
The
just keep stalling, keep farming. Who knows?
But as I was talking about, Betsy, he's the primary AP threat for this team. And he's so far behind that Rocket can just itemize damage at this point, or itemize armor rather at this point. Now Betsy, he's being set even further behind, all the way back to Foundry. Diamond Prox can't get in there to defend him.
Yeah, once so Rocket engage squad, we'll call him, land one CC, the rest is just gonna keep knocking him up, down, in the wall. Betsy can't even move, doesn't have a Zhonyas, no flash to get out of there. Once you get caught, you're instantly dead against this lineup. And even if you survive, you haven't even touched Nuke Duck or Woolite.
I said, Rocket was blasting off again last time we saw them play yesterday, but today they're taking off in style against Gambit Gaming, and this could amount to the final push.
This
might
could
wait
be
for
the final
minutes,
push. I wonder what this means for Gambit as a roster, going 0-2 here in the opening week of LCS.
Especially with their new AD carry, we'll have to see how that one develops. But for right now, back into this game, inhibitor number 2 going down. Super Minions knocking at the door up top, and Rocket decide to back, take the safe play. They got
like
a free
this.
Dragon out of this.
I like that they take the safe route as well. Teams can get greedy here. You can maybe throw. If you take the safe route, there's almost no way to lose this game, barring no way to lose this game. And this fight is going to be pretty brutal for Gambit.
Yeah, they can stretch him pretty thin here now that there's two inhibitors gone. Gambit have to defend on multiple fronts, and Rocket only have to knock down one. Diamond Prox is coming in for the flank. Does he have enough damage? Looks like they've softened Rocket up for just a moment, but can they execute? It looks like it's going to be difficult, but a whole lot of zone. Emperor's Divine, well, it's already finished off. Diamond Prox, Gobble Shard, Gosu Pepper, knocked up, but Vander's dead. Betsy is kiting Steve. Steve, Twisted Advance, but I don't think he'll live through that one. They've managed to melt through Rocket's front line. Only Nuke Duck and Yankos will live to tell the tale of that fight.
Fantastic fight by Gambit, but a lack of patience on Rocket's side. Why would you get in that position when you have Super Creeps on the middle lane, on the top lane, knocking on that Nexus? They could have just waited 30 more seconds and they had the game in the palm of their hands. Really good reaction by Gambit. They had to go for this play and it worked out.
Yep, you were saying that that throw can always happen. They still grab the dragon at the end of it all, but let's see how that one went for Gambit.
Keep your eyes on Cabochard. Betsy flashes in fantastic ulti, forces Wulite to walk back. Watch Cabochard right now. He's going to pop his E and get to Wulite. The poke from Forgiven sets him up for a kill. Emperor's Divide is too late and basically puts Gambit back into a safe position. They can't follow up. Steve's tankiness is eventually going to run out. Betsy survives miraculously on one way or the other, and yeah, Gambit stays in his game.
Yeah, it was a great knockup from Vander, but there just wasn't anything to back it up once it was all said and done. So, Rocket do secure Dragon number 4. You're dangerously close to that number 5 if that game keeps on a-going. Take stock of where we are in the situation right now. Rocket at 38 and a half minutes have themselves still 5,000 gold ahead. Doesn't mean as much as it did several minutes ago, but at 38 and a half, they've got a 3-dragon advantage. Let's see if they can keep on pushing it with 2 inhibitors down on the Gambit Gaming side.
And this is why Victor was such a good meta pick back in the day, because his late game AoE potential is absolutely destructing. He can really wreck an entire team, especially when those both safe carries are huddled together trying to get away from the team. You don't want to get that AoE, you don't want to get that double stun from Cabochard. However, he used his flash and that's really, really vital.
Mm-hmm. He'll have Ghost up, or it looks like he does have Ghost available to him. So at least there's that, but yeah, this is the one weak point in what Rocket has been doing is they've been itemizing for the AD of Gambit Gaming, but they haven't been as much until recently for the AP. And now, you know, that's the threat. When Betsy does start to become a threat, he has started to get that way. He wasn't a few minutes before. Now let's see how this next Baron goes. It's 20 seconds on it, and Rocket are already setting up for position. They found Diamond Prox. Yankos on the chase.
His flash is about to come out. I really hope for Diamond Prox that he doesn't have to use his flash, but it looks like he will have to if he wants to get a chance of stealing his Baron.
Oh.
Ooh.
Not a lot of stuff connecting there.
Synergy.
Chase the bear. Let's see if Forgiven can do anything about this one. True Shot Barrage will knock 3, but Diamond's already down. Doesn't elect to use the flash, and now Baron alive.
Just came up, but even if he had used it, that would mean he had to walk through that pit again. We had a repeat of the earlier scenario. This Baron is going to Rocket. No smite. Don't even try to contest this Gambit.
No, it goes away, and now Vander comes in. He knocks Forgiven in to the wall. Steve,
here's
right
Steve
in the middle of it all. He just doesn't seem to care. And now,
okay,
in the gaming, yep, Ghostu Pepper's gonna get a hook on Wulite, but it won't matter. Everyone from Gambit, they've backed out or died. 3 members down now with Diamond Prox's still half a minute before he respawns. Rocket in prime position right now. Inhibitor respawned up in the top, but I don't think that's gonna last very long.
Remember, 5 members, 5 against 2. Gonna make a not so bold prediction here. Game's gonna end in Rocket's favor, and yeah, fantastic staying in that game, fighting through the way that Steve got behind. Signature move doesn't seem to work over and over. Steve stayed in the game, and
speaking
Rocket's taking
moves.
It.
Yep, looks like they will end this game in style. 40 minutes and some change in. They finish off Gambit Gaming and go 1-1 to start the summer split. There we go. Big
the crowd.
Chance for Steve now. He's earned it. It was a good game for him.
Yeah, very, very resilient showing from Steve. Still has to work on the early safety. When you know that you went down like that before, you didn't recover in the LCS, you're playing a champion. Often when you look at the picks, they can tell you the way it's likely the early game is going to happen, and I think Steve could have played a little more careful. At the same time, props to Gambit, or to Rocket's bot lane, rather. Play a losing early game matchup, but they have the scaling on their side. Wulite lost his flash early, but still died 5 times this game. But I guess the real hero is Nuke Duck. 4-0-11 on Azir.
We critiqued him a lot yesterday, and he just didn't really seem to have as much of an impact against H2K. But like, you look at what he did this game. 4-0-11, he went deathless, he had some insane Azir sacks. what a huge play from him over and over again. And, you know, you can't give him enough props for that.
Yeah, and I'm just staring at my screen here, and I'm just checking on Vander's Alistar, 5-2 and 13. Another impressive Alistar performance. I think when time moves on, week two, week three, Alistar is probably or likely to become a more staple support pick and join these other picks in first pick and ban-worthy champions, especially because his innate tankiness when he pops that Unbreakable Will, his peeling, his engage, and his ability to get safely through lane. If we call back to Miffy's interview on the analyst desk earlier, he said, all these LCS pros, right, they care about laning, 2v2, you know, 2v1, I don't care. I'm going to get through the lane and play utility for my team, and Alistar is so fantastic at doing that. We saw Vander in a couple of these fights. The double kill pulverized, the peeling, a lot of headbutts that worked well into Rocket's favor, and really looking out for more Alistar play in the future.
Yeah, and on the other side of the coin, too, I really, really want to commend Gosu Pepper's Thresh performance. I think he really stepped up from where he was yesterday, especially. He got some really, really crucial hooks. The problem was, the later the game went on, he wasn't always able to find the right targets in the chaos, and it just sort of fell apart because there really wasn't any follow-up they could do at the end of the game. But up until that point, he was doing quite well.
Yeah, not a fan of the Ezreal Thresh lane, but we'll see. Maybe it works in the future for Gambit.
Yeah, well, they're still looking to find an identity. But for now, we're going to go Riftside, where Quickshot is...